when you are in Christ Jesus, you don't have to go searching out anything anywhere outside, because in Christ we have everything that God gives us according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. All my needs are taken care of in Christ, physical and spiritual. If you believe that, shout an amen. Chapter 1 of Corinthians is an amazing letter written by Paul to the Corinthian church. And you must understand that the Corinthian church believers are not there at. These are the kind of believers that were in the church, but one foot in the world. Every sin you talk, these believers had. You read the writings of Apostle Paul, that there should not be any trouble in the church, that there should not be any sexual immorality in the believers of the church. He's talking them to walk in love. In one chapter of love, he has written to them. But Paul is starting this epistle, as I told you last week, that he's addressing them in verse 2 as beloved saints of Christ. Friends, as much as we have sin in our life, because we are living in a dead, sinful world and a wicked world, God looks at us as holy people, because not because of our righteousness, because of the righteousness that is imputed into us, grafted into us, because of the righteousness of his son Jesus Christ. So Paul's purpose in writing to the Corinthians this letter is that since God is looking at you as a holy generation, a saint of God, since God is blessing you so abundantly, but when I look into your lifestyle, there are areas where you are unholy, unethical, wickedness still creeping on into your lifestyle, and you are living like an old man. Now that God is calling you holy, behave holy. Behave in a way that qualifies the way God looks at you. You need to change your lifestyle and be holy. And in presenting this letter in chapter 1, I understand from my understanding of God's word that Paul is giving the readers to know what are the benefits of Christianity. If you are here today knowing what you will get out of being a Christian or a believer, this is a divine presentation of what benefit you can have in your life since you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The first benefit that comes to us because of being a child of God is that we are being given the grace, undeserved grace and kindness of God. And the moment we are born again and we became the child of God, God's grace covers our past and we are forgiven. And as you walk in your Christian life, and when we entangle with sin, and when the dust and the sin of this world entangle our lives, anytime we come back to the grace of God and tell God, I'm sorry, forgive me, there is God's grace in the present to forgive us and to bless us, my dear child, and bring us back to the presence of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. And God's grace is not only for the spiritual, I told you last week. It covers our physical realm. It covers our family. It covers our health. And we experience God's grace in every dimension of our life. And God's grace leads us to eternity. Moving to the second benefit of being a Christian is the gift of God. Now, before I talk about the gift of God, I wanted to understand what are the things that God, how God looks at us now that you are saved. Come with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and it's verse 8. Already you have all you want. Already you have become what? Rich. God is telling, when you come to Christ, I have packed your shelves. I have given you everything that you want for purity, knowledge, wisdom, understanding, for life, eternity. Everything comes as a package when you receive the Lord Jesus Christ. When you are in Christ Jesus, You don't have to go searching out anything anywhere outside, because in Christ we have everything that God gives us according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. All my needs are taken care of in Christ, physical and spiritual. If you believe that, shout an amen. Amen. He packs your shelf with all goodies. Amen. From heaven. Come to 2 Peter chapter 1 and it's verse 3. His divine power has given us what? Somebody say. Everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Everything you want to lead a holy life, everything is there in that package of salvation. Everything is there with God. It's not God's problem that we are not leading a holy life. It is our problem that we are not willing to transform our mind and live holy. Come with me to Colossians chapter 2 and it's verse 10. In Christ, you have been brought to fullness. You are complete in God. There is nothing about you that is not complete. When you come to Christ, you are made complete, my dear friends. Hallelujah. We have everything in Christ, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and it's verse 21, Paul says, all things that God has made, everything that belongs to God becomes for a child of God when we become the heirs of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. You and I are not ordinary people. We have everything that we need for life and purity because we accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. His son died so that we may gain in the Lord Jesus. Can you shout a hallelujah? Now that God has given us everything, Paul is describing in detail in chapter 1 about grace. And the second thing that God has given to us at the present is gifts. We all like gifts, right? That when we accept the Lord Jesus Christ, we have been given gifts by God. Everyone is been gifted by God. Somebody turn to your friend and say, you are gifted by God. Amen. Come to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and it's verse 5. For in him you have been enriched in every way with all kinds of speech. The King James Version says utterance, and with all knowledge. So when we come to the Lord Jesus Christ, God gives us gifts. What is the gift that God gives us? All kinds of speech. Somebody say speech. No, it is speech. You need to speak. Come on, speech. That means in the King James Version says all kinds of utterance. And the second gift Paul is mentioning is the gift of knowledge. So we have been in our shelves, we have been given the deposit of God's gifts in our lives. And the first gift is the kinds of different kinds of speech for a child of God. Different kinds of utterance for a child of God. I want to dwell a little in the kinds of utterance, gift of utterance that God gives us when we become a child of God. You know, every one of you have been given power in your tongue as a child of God. And God wants you to utter, use your tongue and exercise the gift of utterance or speech and use the authority as a child of God. Why would God give us this gift of utterance? Number one, to proclaim the gospel. To proclaim the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know that God has given you the capacity and capability to preach the great mystery of the gospel? And who gives you the utterance? It is the Lord, Holy Spirit, gives you the utterance when you open your mouth and use the gift that God has given to you. Speaking the gospel is not the job of the pastor alone. It's not the job of the evangelist alone. Every saint of God, every believer of God should be involved in the work of the gospel. And we need to use this gift of utterance and speak the life-changing gospel that can transform and change any person and the world that we are in. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit will come on you. And you will be my witnesses. You will proclaim about me. You will proclaim my testimony. You will proclaim my word. You will proclaim my gospel in all Jerusalem and all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, the Bible says. Friends, are we proclaiming the gospel? That's what God is looking at, friends. He wants every one of you to take this gospel to the ends of the world and do whatever you can to take the gospel out. We're all worried about my health, my children, my finances. God has not taken care of you. Absolutely has taken care of everything that you need. But God is telling, when are you going to, other than prosperity, no, which I've already given you, what you need I've given you, when are you going to take this message to the ends of the world? Everyone should be involved in preaching the good news to the ends of the world. Secondly, God gives us gift to speak in tongues. God has given us the gift of speaking in tongues. Hallelujah. Thank God for the anointing of speaking in tongues. The Bible says when you speak in tongues, you speak mysteries to God. Friends, there are certain things that the enemy cannot tap. It is a secret wireless hotline between you and God. And that's when you exercise your mouth and speak in tongues. Oh, when you come to church, my throat is gone because I've been praying and preaching, speaking in tongues. I don't bother when we are coming to the presence of God. We exercise our utterance in the presence of God. But it is so sad to see that when believers come to church, the mouth is sealed, sutured. Friends, our very faith in Christ came when we opened our mouth. If you believe with your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you opened your mouth and Christ came inside of you. And our very being and our continuity as a child is when you open your mouth and speak the utterances of the Spirit that the Spirit has for you. Hallelujah. We go to that IPL match, take the ticket, go before time, and we have all voice. Next day, pastor, what happened to your voice, brother? IPL, I'm cheering Kohli. Here, come over here, and King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is over here, and we tell you to shout a hallelujah. Mom in the church. Friends, is this what God redeemed us for? He has given us a mouth to praise the name of our Creator, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Somebody shout and praise Him this morning time. Hallelujah. Those who speak in tongues edifies themselves. If you feel that speaking in tongues is something foreign, come to our fasting prayers. Most of the time we speak in tongues. And you don't copy anyone's tongue. You open your mouth wide. The Bible says, I will fill it. Psalm 81. And many of you are doubting tongues because you are not releasing your tongue for the utterance of the Spirit of God. Come on, lift your hands up right now. Everybody, everybody, the whole church. Amen. If you are powered with the power of speaking in tongues, speak in tongues. Otherwise, praise the name of God. Come on, for some time. Let us praise God for some time. Let the principalities come down even as we praise Him right now. Come on, everybody. Don't be dignified. Be undignified in the presence of God. Ruja raba shikara da rabanasi. Rike re de reba balaradana mashukara da rabasi. Come on, I want to hear a voice, church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We need the Holy Spirit to give us the utterance. And it edifies the believer. You feel discouraged? Go home. Speak in tongues for an hour. And you see how encouraged the Holy Spirit will minister to you. Thirdly, the Spirit gives us utterance to preach the word of God boldly. I'm a very timid person when I'm outside the stage. You have seen me, how I talk, how I relate. But when I come to the presence of God, I get the boldness of Stephen. I get the boldness of Peter. And we preach Christ crucified with the boldness that God gives us in the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Friends, God has given you His Spirit to preach the Word of God boldly. Not only me, everyone has been given this God's Word so that you will preach, you will talk, you will teach, you will meditate, and you will speak. And when you start speaking, God will give you the utterance to speak. But if you don't open your mouth, how can God give you the utterance? All that we speak is, "Pastor, I'm so discouraged. I'm so tired. I don't know how I will go." Amen. You are what you speak. I'm not telling about prosperity theology. You speak the grace of God. You speak the will of God. You speak the promises of God. You speak the word of God. And you see how God will encourage you, my friends. He will give you the utterance for that time. And that one utterance by the Spirit against the demons and the darkness that is coming against us will bring down the strongholds and take you to the next level when you are in the spirit realm. And only if you understand it, you know what I'm speaking. Acts chapter 4 verse 31. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. First of all, if the Holy Spirit has to come, you have to open your mouth. And then when you speak the word of God, you will be given the utterance to speak the word of God boldly. It's time to discern the different kinds of preaching that we hear in our times. Preaching goes up and down and story and make you feel good. It's not a bold preaching. It's a man-pleasing preaching. Don't go after that. Don't forward such preaching and fool the people around you. When the Holy Spirit comes, there is boldness. You speak the truth, friends. And this is a narrow gate. It's not a wide gate for everyone to enter. Don't think that you sing and you dance and you are in heaven. Christianity and the way of God is a narrow gate. And you need to come to that level where you preach the word of God, undiluted word of God, boldly from your mouth. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 19. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. This is a mystery. And when I'm speaking, God is leading me deeper into the mystery of the gospel. All that we need is over here. But there are certain things only when pastors speak, the Lord gives utterance and the people understand it for that moment and gives the deliverance. And Paul is telling, pray for me. I'm asking you to pray for me so that I don't want to get down in my anointing, but I want to grow in my anointing, my closeness with God. So that Sunday after Sunday when you come here, you will hear from the mouth of God Himself. Every believer has this utterance. Not only me. You have the utterance to proclaim the gospel, to speak in tongues, and to preach the word of God boldly. Come to Matthew's gospel chapter 10, verse 19 to 20. See what Jesus said when He's sending people. When they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say. Utterance, the gift of utterance that God has given to the believers. At that moment, when you go through a trying situation, God will give you that utterance. For it will be not you who will be speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Amen. Can I hear a better amen, friends? Somebody say, "I am filled with the gift of utterance." Amen. You are in that situation and you speak that word in the spirit, your strongholds will be broken. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, the next one. Gift of knowledge. Gift of knowledge. 1 Corinthians 1:5, or in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech, with all knowledge. Now listen, if I have got all the utterance and I have no knowledge, I will be speaking utter rubbish. You understand very clearly. Don't ever think that you have a tongue and you can speak anything that you want in the name of Jesus. There is a clear balance in God's word. There is knowledge from the presence of God. And where do we get the knowledge? God's word. Without this, no prophecy. Without this, no gospel. Without this, no preaching. Everything has to be based and rooted in the knowledge of God that has been revealed to man. So, it is a balanced Christian life. It's not that you always in the spirit and spirit and spirit and spirit and you don't know what is the word. You need to use the spirit when the time, God gives you the time. Be in the spirit and use it. We walk by the spirit. But other times, get into the word of God. Many people read a lot of books. And more than books, Bible, they give importance to biblical books. I'm not against that. But nothing should take away your devotion, or your primary devotion should be God's word. Amen? Everything and anything that comes out of God's word. Now listen what the Bible says. 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 15. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason of the hope that you have in you. So the Bible says preparation. Bible says preparation, friends. Yes or no? How? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's my preparation. That is fooling God. Getting some good promises from here and there without the context and telling God, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Read the Bible systematically, book by book. That's why I preach book by book, passage by passage. Otherwise, you will not understand anything. The mode of preaching and the mode of studying the Bible is passage by passage. You go deep into it and God reveals you the mystery of God's word. Hallelujah. And look at what God says about his own word. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 9. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. What is given here is the fullness of God's wisdom. But what is given here is also a part of God's divine wisdom that will be revealed in the distant eternity. There is much, much, much more that God has to teach us than what we have received in God's word. But let me tell you very clearly, everything has to be rooted. Whatever mystery God reveals in eternity, whatever mystery any pastor or any prophet reveals now has to be rooted in the basic foundation of the divine word of God. That is the standard of God, because there is no adding and subtracting to the scripture of the divine God. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 1:7. Therefore, you do not lack anything. Do not lack any spiritual gift, as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. First is the gift of utterance, gift of knowledge, and then the Bible is speaking about spiritual gifts. Now, every one of you have been given gifts, spiritual gifts, when you have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. Chapter 12 talks very clearly about spiritual gifts. God willing, if I am led to go till chapter 12, we will meditate on that. Why spiritual gifts? To serve the church. Everyone attending a church has been given special gifts. As we are proclaiming God's word, as we are prophesying, and as we are praying in tongues, and as we are preaching, maybe at our home, at our office, to our children, wherever you are, God has given specialized gifts to be exercised in the church of God or in the body of Christ. I am doing to you the gift of preaching, the gift of teaching, Brother Abby was leading you into the gift of worship. Then there are Sister Veena and the entire team, the gift of hospitality. The communion ushers team, the gift of hospitality. And the Bible says, every one of you have at least one gift, so that the body of Christ can be helped and edified. And God is looking at you to exercise your gift, either somewhere outside in the body of Christ or in the church that God has called you. Now look at this, Corinthian believers. God is calling them holy, saint. God is telling that you are speaking in tongues, you are preaching, you are prophesying, you are doing everything with boldness, and you are not lacking spiritual gifts. 1 Corinthians 12:1. About the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. That means they are already informed. They are all using their gift in the church. Look at this, friends. And still, where is their life? Pathetic. Living in sin. Living in adultery. Don't think that anyone who is on stage is a holy person. Any worship leader or any singer, I'm not talking about me or I'm not talking about my team. Anywhere in the world, keeping all the sins of the world, you can still stand on the pulpit and preach. That doesn't mean that there's a holy person. His life should show out. In his love and his behavior, the way he deals, you can make out whether he's a genuine man of God or a genuine worshiper. Paul is telling, you guys are exercising everything in the church, playing music and singing and preaching and hospitality, but look at your lives, how adulterous lifestyle you are living. Is it because of the lack of knowledge? He's telling them, no. Whatever you need has been revealed in the scripture. Everything that you need for holiness and goodness has been given to you. You are complete in Christ. Christ has given you everything. It's not that you don't know. It's not that you have not been given the gifts. He has still given the gifts. He is still using you. But now that you are doing all this and Christ is waiting for your repentance, turn back and come to the presence of God in holiness and sanctity of life.